permitted forcing subject or data communication in computer networks. Myself, Prakash Mina, assistant professor in computer science and engineering, Indian College admit. So, we have two topics today. Hierarchical routing and broadcast routing. So, let's start with hierarchical routing. It is when we saw there is more slides, so we have a diagram and we also have a diagram and some concepts. So let's start with hierarchical routing. And network grows inside the router, routing tables grow proportionally and not only in router memory consumed by ever increasing tables, but more CPU time is needed to scale them. And more bandwidth is needed to send status reports about them. And at a certain point, the network may grow to the point where it is no longer feasible for every router to have an entry for every other routers. And so the routing will have to be done hierarchically as it is in the just like telephone network. And when hierarchical routing is used, the routers are divided into what we will call regions. Each router knows all the details about how to route packets to destination within its own region, but knows nothing about the internal structure of other regions. And when different networks are interconnected, it is natural to regard each one as a separate region to free the routers in one network and from having to know the topological structure of other ones. So, for these networks, a two-level hierarchy may be insufficient. You can say the hierarchy or hierarchy, but it's mostly a hierarchy, so maybe it may be inefficient for large networks, and it may be necessary to group the region into clusters, and the clusters into zones, and zones into groups, and so on. And until we run out of names for aggregation, so there are lots of layers in hierarchical routing. So as you can see here in hierarchical routing diagram, for region 1, region 2, region 3, region 4, region 5, and there is a full table for 1A and hierarchical table for 1A. So the figure gives a quantitative examples of routing in the two-level hierarchy with 5 regions. The full routing table for router 1A has 17 entries, as you can see here in figure B. And when routing is done hierarchically, so figure 3, there are entries for all the local routers, and but all other regions are condensed into a single router. So all traffic for region 2 goes via the 1B to 2A line, but the rest of the remote traffic goes via the 1C to 3B line. And hierarchical routing has reduced the table from 17 to 7 entries, and as the ratio of the number of regions to the number of routers per region goes, the saving in table space increases. So unfortunately, these gains in a space are not free. There is a penalty to pay, include path length, and for example, the best route from 1A to 5C is via region 2, but with hierarchical routing, all traffic to region 5 goes via region 3, because that is better for most destinations in region 5. And when a single network becomes very large and interesting questions generate, so how many levels should the hierarchy have? And for example, consider a network with 720 routers. If there is no hierarchy, each router needs 720 routing table entries. If the network is partitioned into 24 regions of 30 routers each, each router needs 30 local routers plus 23 remote entries for a total of 53 entries. And if a 3-level hierarchy is chosen with 8 clusters, each containing 9 regions of 10 routers, and each router needs 10 entries for local routers, and n entries for routing to other regions within its own cluster, and 7 entries for distance cluster for a total of 25 entries. So there is a common entry for 1979 discovered that the optimum number of levels for an N router is in users. So they have also shown that the increase in effective mean path lengths called by hierarchical routing is sufficiently small that it is usually acceptable. So that's all for hierarchical routing. So the next is broadcast routing. So in some applications, host need to send messages to many or all other hosts. For example, a server or service distributing weather reports, stock market updates or live radio programs might work best by sending to all machines and letting those that are interested read the data and sending a packet to all destinations simultaneously is called broadcasting. And various methods have been proposed for doing it. One broadcasting method that requires no special feature from the network is for the source to simply send a distinct packet to each destination. And not only is the method wasteful of bandwidth and slow, but it is also required the source to have a complete list of all destinations. And this method is not desirable in practice, even though it is widely applicable. And an improvement is multi-destination routing, in which each packet contains either a list of destination or a heat map indicating the desired destination. And when a packet arrives at the router checks all the destinations to determine the set of output lines that will be needed. And the router represents a new copy of the packet for each output line to be used and includes in each packet only those destinations that are to use the line. And in effect, the destination set is partitioned among the output lines. And after a sufficient number of hosts, each packet will carry only one destination like normal packet. And multi-destination routing is like using separately addressed packet, except that when several packets must follow the same route and one of them pays full fare and the rest ride free. And the network bandwidth is therefore used more efficiently. And this scheme still requires the source to know all the destinations, plus it is as much work for a router to determine where to send one multi-destination packet as it is for multiple distinct packets. And already we have seen a better broadcast routing technique like flooding, and when implemented with a sequence number for a source, flooding uses links efficiently with a decision tool of router that is relatively simple. And although flooding is suited for ordinary point-to-point communication, it creates serious consideration for broadcasting. And it turns out that we can do better still once the shorter path routes for regular packets have been computed. And the idea for reverse path forwardings, so this is the second method or third method, and is elegant and remarkably simple once it has been pointed out. And when a broadcast packet arrives at a router, the router checks to see if the packet arrived on the link that is normally used for sending packets towards the source of the broadcast, and if so, there is an excellent chance that the broadcast packet itself allowed the best route from the router and is therefore the first copy to arrive at the router. And this being the case, so the router forwards copies of it onto all links except the one it arrived on. And if the broadcast packet arrived on a link other than the preferred one for reaching the source, the packet is discarded as a likely duplicate. And you can see here an example reverse path forwarding. So an example of reverse path forwarding shown in figure. So in part A shows a network, and part B shows a sync tree for router I of that network, and part C shows how the reverse path algorithm works. And on the first hop, I sends packet to S at J and N, and as indicated by the second row of the tree, and each of these packets arrive on the preferred path to I. And is so indicated by a circle around the letter you can see here. And on the second hop, the 8 packets are generated, fully by each of the routers that received a packet on the first hop, and as it turns out, all 8 of these arrives are previously unvisited routers, and 5 of these arrives along the preferred line. Of the 6 packets generated on the third hop, only 3 arrives on the preferred path at CEK, and the others are duplicate. And after 5 hops, the 24 packets, the broadcasting terminates, and compared with 4 hops and 14 packets, that packets had the same tree being followed exactly. And the principal advantage of US path forwarding is that it is efficient while being easy to implement, and it sends the broadcast packet over each link only once in each direction,
and just as in plugging gate, it requires only that routers know how to